Good morning and welcome to the Core Connection. I'm Mira Rubin here with you on Enlightened World Network. Today's topic is trust. But before we get started, let's settle in and get connected here. Let's take a deep breath in through your nose. Hold it and allow the energy of that breath to just move throughout all your being, through your cells, through your organs, through your skin and your bones. And exhale and gently relax. And let's take another deep breath in. Hold it and feel all that energy surging through your body and moving beyond and just expanding out into the world beyond you. And exhale any tension. And then let's gently press our palms together and softly rub your fingers against your palms. Feel your fingers, feel your palms. Feel that tingling and bring yourselves present right here, right now. So the topic of trust, it's a thorny topic. You know, I am inclined to encourage people to trust themselves, and in having that conversation, I think back to a time in my life where I most certainly didn't trust myself and I didn't consider myself trustworthy. And one of the reasons for not feeling trustworthy or not trusting myself is because I would make promises to myself that I didn't keep. Like I would say that I was going to do a diet or exercise or get certain things done, and then I wouldn't do those things, and I would perhaps I was better at making promises and keeping promises that I made to other people than I was to myself. But the broken promises to myself really engendered a lack of trust for myself. And so I've been thinking about this because I'm at a place in my life where I do trust myself, and I was looking at what's different. And I notice that what's different is, first, I'm a lot less reactive. So one of the reasons that I was unable to trust myself in the past was that I was easily triggered by things and kind of had a runaway momentum in my mind and reactions that I was unable to control or to divert. And so when we think about trust and building trust in ourselves, I think that the first and probably most important step is to be examining our reactivity, examining where we need healing, because to be able to really find oneself in alignment, it's necessary to heal ourselves first. So what does that look like? I think it starts with first recognizing the things that we judge about ourselves, and to start looking more deeply at those things that we judge about ourselves and find a way, a path to forgiveness, self-forgiveness, and forgiveness as a path to healing. So recognizing that certain patterns that we may have that are destructive even may have originated, most likely originated, with an intention for survival or protection or self-care, in oftentimes a backward way. So for example, I actually used to have a borderline eating disorder where I would eat to numb myself and also to comfort myself all at the same time. Good morning, Sally. So glad you're here. I'm talking about trust and self-trust and coming into alignment with ourselves. So I was talking about having had this compulsion, eating compulsion, and what eating in that context did for me was it gave me a way to comfort myself, to numb myself. And initially, that was the intention, and then it became something that I was subject to and that I couldn't control. And feeling that I couldn't control that made me feel a greater lack of trust for myself. And Jennifer Reeser, good morning. Great to see you here. She says, we need to put the oxygen mask on ourselves first. Well, yeah, because until we trust ourselves, we don't have the capability to trust life or to trust the universe, so to speak, or to trust others. And so I think that there's such foment right now, so much going on. Good morning, Dido. Welcome. So glad you're here. There's so much going on that requires our discernment. And so I want to, as I was trying to unpack the notion of discernment, what came up was trust. So that's why I'm talking about this. So in looking back at this compulsive eating that I did in my past quite a long time ago, as I allowed myself to be present to my wounds and to move through those wounds with help in many cases, through trainings or counseling. But as it's very hot here, it's like 90 degrees. So as I allowed myself to move through my wounds, my behavior shifted. As I allowed myself to feel my feelings, to know what was going on inside me, to allow myself to move beyond the stories of victimhood that I was carrying, I was able to be in greater alignment with myself, and that cultivated more trust. So, Sally says, yes, I've been there. Once I gained better control of myself and my emotions, I dropped 77 pounds. Beautiful, Sally. That's huge. And so, yes, as we come into greater alignment and also greater compassion for ourselves, then we have a greater ability to trust ourselves. So, I think the not trust or the distrust or the behaviors that lead to distrust also can feed feelings of self-hatred and self-condemnation. And I think the transformation from self-condemnation to compassion is a really, really powerful vehicle to healing, to recognize that whatever those behaviors are, whatever those ideas are that we have about ourselves, if we're able to hear them and to ask questions such as, what must I believe in order to think that of myself or of others? And what must I be feeling to take these kinds of actions that are destructive to me? You know, what must I, maybe I feel like I need to be punished. And so when we recognize those things, it does take stepping back to be able to see ourselves through a meta lens, you know, from like a higher up level, to look compassionately and say, hey, what the heck's going on here? what is going on with this? Where, wh what do I need to be thinking in order to be eating a half gallon of ice cream at one crack? And I actually did that on multiple occasions a long, long time ago. Then we can move into a place of deeper connection and compassion, and find a place or a part of ourselves that can parent us compassionately and lovingly. And this all comes back around to allowing ourselves to grow the relationship with ourselves such that we can begin to cultivate and expand our experience of trust for ourselves. And another deep, deep part of trust, self-trust, is connecting with your intuition, like your gut feeling, over and above perhaps your thoughts, because thoughts can be mechanistic. Thoughts can be like a hamster running on one of those little wheels, just going around and around and around. And they can, as they go around, build momentum that further cements the thought, and the attendant feeling can, you can work yourself up into a frenzy. And that's typically how we do that, how we get into a rather challenged emotional state, is through the thoughts and the pattern thoughts that we run over and over and over again. So what we can learn to do is to change our state. And I know I've spoken about this before, but we can deliberately choose to change our state by if we're seated, jumping up and shaking it out, or singing a song, or sometimes playing music or dancing or whatever, to change the state and then give ourselves an opportunity to introduce a new conversation that can shift our emotion and that can bring us back to a place of centeredness. And of course, deep breathing is also a really powerful way to move through a state, or to break a pattern of thought. So it's interesting because we want to be able to attend to the experience of emotion, the emotional experience, and we also want to not be feeding that with patterned repetitive thought. So you can easily break the pattern of thought, which may break that emotional state as well. The key here is to find your path to separating the emotion from the story, because the emotion is energetic, and I guess in certain ways the thought is energetic too. They're intertwined, but we do have the power to allow those emotions to move through, and as we do transform the emotions, it has the capability to shift the whole thinking as well. We can shift the thinking to shift emotions, we can shift emotions to shift the thinking. However, the emotions are a physical thing. It's a physical thing that happens when we experience different emotions. There are all different chemicals that get released in our bodies. So as we deliberately either allow ourselves to move through those emotions, or we shift the focus and shift the experience of the emotions, we are changing physiology. And there are times, I guess there are times for both approaches. It's interesting that a conversation about trust took us down this windy way, but I want to really recognize that As we come into greater alignment with ourselves, as we develop greater trust for ourselves, we have less need of defensiveness because we can trust ourselves to put ourselves in situations that are appropriate. We can trust ourselves to respond rather than react. We can trust ourselves to make good decisions. We can compassionately allow ourselves to grow and confront our own weaknesses. We can, as we trust ourselves more, we can shine a light on the things about ourselves that we want to change and move through. And I know so many people talk about protection, especially people that are empathic, that are very susceptible to other people's energy. And as we become more whole, as we become more integrated and unified and aligned, my belief is that we become our own protection, that we don't necessarily have need of additional shields because we're whole and complete. And trust is a big component of becoming whole and complete and aligned. So I know so many people speak that they have trust issues. I certainly did in the past, and it was, or they were directly related to the fact that I didn't really trust myself. And all of this conversation about trust is very much related to the need to trust ourselves in our discernment about what is happening in the world, about how to make sense of what's going on in the world. And why I focused on trusting ourselves is because if we trust ourselves, then we don't have to trust our welfare or entrust other people with the power to make decisions for us. So we can be discerning about the people that we choose to trust. And I probably, like so many of you, have trusted the wrong people at different times in my life, and it was also because I didn't trust myself. And so I deferred to others when I did not trust myself. So it's a thorny issue, this trust thing, and there are degrees of it, and it is a lifelong learning, I believe. I don't think that we should blindly trust anyone or anything, is what it comes down to. And in terms of blind trust, I think that means ourselves as well, is we need to be willing to trust our gut. I think that when it comes down to it, our deep intuition is much wiser than our mind. And as I think the bottom line to this conversation that I'm having with you and having with myself is that we do have access when we connect to our deepest intuition beyond our thoughts and ideas. So when we connect to our heart and we connect to the intelligence in our gut, that's where our wisdom really comes from. And the mind will churn and question and challenge and and repeat programming that may not be true to our heart and our soul. And so when it comes down to it, one, we talked about forgiveness of self being a really powerful movement toward trust, compassion toward self, and most importantly, is connection with heart and gut to go beyond the limits of the mind and to find a deeper and more powerful alignment with our core being. So Jennifer says, I'm trusting myself to be able to teach my grandchildren what I know now so they have a better awareness of themselves. I needed this reminder this morning. I agree with not blindly trusting. I followed my instinct several times this week and was pleasantly surprised at myself. I'm growing and expanding. Thank you, Mira. Thank you, Jennifer. I am so glad to hear that you trusted your instinct, because really, our instinct, when our real gut instinct, rather than reactivity, our real gut and heart knows what to trust, and knows when there's danger, and knows when we're safe, and knows how to navigate. And the more we're able to connect with that inner wisdom, the better everybody's going to be. Good morning, Harvey. So thank you for being here, Harvey. Anyway, I am going to sign off. I so appreciate your engaging with me, and I'm thrilled to be having you here. I'm very grateful. And I hope you find these morning chats useful. I'm Mira Rubin here on Enlightened World Network, and please check out the other wonderful programming that is available on this Facebook channel. And Dido says, I'm going to share this with my teenage son. I wish I had known this when I was his age. That's beautiful. Wow. Thank you. And Sally says, thank you. You are so welcome. Thank you. Thank you really for being here and for giving me folks to engage with. I so appreciate it. And it means so much to me to have this connection with you. And with that, I hope you'll join me tomorrow morning. I'm here every weekday morning at 9 a.m. And so much love and compassion to you.